in-depth exploration of the US Navy's Constellation FFG-62 class frigate program. This is the story of a next-generation warship, of ambitious plans, evolving challenges, and steadfast determination to deliver vessels that will protect America's interests on the world's oceans for decades to come. In 2020, the US Navy took its first steps toward a new class of guided missile frigates by awarding a contract to Fincantieri Marinette Marine, often referred to as FMM, in Marinette, Wisconsin. This was the beginning of what we now call the Constellation FFG-62 class frigate program, previously known by its working title, FFGX. From 2020 through 2024, Congress funded a total of 6 of these frigates. At least 20 are planned to serve as a modern, more cost-effective supplement to the Navy's larger cruisers and destroyers.
When the Navy goes to Congress and says, we want to retire ships, all Congress wants to think about is, we already are short on ships. Why are you getting rid of more ships?
The 7th frigate, requested in fiscal year 2025, comes with a price tag of approximately $1.2 billion. From 2026 to 2029, the Navy's budget submission calls for 6 more FFG-62s in annual increments of 2, 1, 2, and 1.
The Navy's frigate program, or its Constellation class of ships, are a multi-mission small surface combatant that are based on a European frigate design. The frigate program was put in place because of failures on the littoral combat ship program.
It's going to cost about $22 billion over the next few decades to procure about 20 ships. The design has slowed and construction has stalled, and the Navy has recently reported at least a 3-year delay in lead ship delivery from 2026 to 2029.
However, the project has not been without headwinds. In April 2024, the Navy publicly announced the first ship, originally slated for delivery in April 2026, was now forecasted to arrive 36 months later than initially planned. According to a May 2024 Government Accountability Office, GAO, report, design delays and workforce shortages at the shipyard have all contributed to this considerable setback. The strategic role of the frigate. The Navy divides its surface fleet into 2 categories: large surface combatants, LSCs. This group includes cruisers and destroyers designed to operate in high-threat areas.
My entire engineering department on LCS is about 12 people. That is about the size of one engineering division on conventional ships.
Small surface combatants, SSCs. Here you'll find frigates, littoral combat ships, mine warfare ships, and patrol craft. These are often meant for lower threat operations or to complement LSCs in a more distributed strategy. At the end of fiscal year 2023, the Navy's SSC force stood at 31 ships, including 23 littoral combat ships and 8 mine warfare ships, yet no frigates. Meanwhile, the Navy's force level goal points toward a future with 73 SSCs, a substantial portion of which will be the new Constellation-class frigates, a nod to history. Historically, the United States has fielded frigates for centuries, dating back to 6 powerful warships authorized by Congress in 1794. United States, Constellation, Constitution, Chesapeake, Congress, and President. More recently, the Oliver Hazard Perry FFG-7 class frigates, built between the 1970s and 1980s, were essential to the Navy's smaller combatant force until their decommissioning in 2015. Now, the Constellation class, which revives one of the oldest and most storied names, is set to bring modern technology and robust multi-mission capabilities to the fore. The Constellation class at a glance. The Navy renamed the FFG-X program to Constellation FFG-62 in tribute to America's earliest frigates. Key highlights include multi-mission profile designed to conduct anti-air warfare, AAW, anti-surface warfare, ASUW, anti-submarine warfare, ASW, and electromagnetic warfare, EMW. Parent design built upon the Italian-French Frem frigate hull, yet significantly modified to meet American requirements, so much so that some sources suggest design commonality with the original Frem has dropped below 15%. Planned fleet size, at least 20 ships, with the potential for more if the Navy updates its 30-year shipbuilding plans. Procurement costs, typically $1.1 to $1.2 billion per unit, slightly higher for the lead ship due to first-in-class design and startup costs. Mission and capabilities. When it comes to missions and capabilities, The Constellation class is set to be a true workhorse for the Navy. Let's explore what that means in detail. Intended missions, independent ops. Perfect for maritime security, presence operations, and tasks like anti-piracy and lower-intensity conflict zones. Integrated with carrier or expeditionary strike groups, bolsters the strike group's anti-submarine, anti-surface, and anti-air capabilities, while allowing more expensive destroyers or cruisers to focus on the most high-end missions. Escort missions defends logistics ships, amphibious ready groups, or other valuable assets, particularly in areas where submarine or surface threats loom large. Overall, the Navy envisions this class serving as a utility player, cost-effective, agile, and robust enough to hold its own in a variety of mission profiles. Key capabilities: anti-air warfare, AAW. Advanced radar, expected to carry an Enterprise Air Surveillance Radar, EASR variant, along with an Aegis-based combat system, scaled for a smaller platform, yet still powerful enough to detect and track aerial threats. Vertical launch system, VLS. 32 Mark 41 VLS cells to accommodate a range of missiles, such as standard missiles, your SM, for medium your long-range engagements, and evolved Sea Sparrow missiles, ESSM, for closer-in threats. Rolling airframe missile, RAM, a separate 21-cell launcher dedicated to close-in point defense, crucial for fending off anti-ship missiles. B anti-surface warfare, ASUW, medium-caliber gun, likely a 57mm or 76mm main gun for engagement of smaller craft or shore targets. Over-the-horizon missiles, typically up to 16 deck-mounted anti-ship cruise missiles, like the Naval Strike Missile, extend the frigate's striking power against enemy surface combatants. Sea anti-submarine warfare, ASW.
Today, anti-submarine warfare, or ASW, has changed significantly with increased capability in both anti-submarine and anti-surface technology. NATO can locate submarines using modern frigates with low-frequency active sonar and air assets like helicopters, as well through location devices on new modern submarines, depending on the task.
Durch, drauf, eingeschrieben, 015 einfahren.
In some cases, maybe his job to find the submarine, in some cases, maybe his job just to stay away from the submarine. So he has different missions depending on how the exercises are laid out.
CAPTAS, four variable depth sonar, towed beneath surface layer noise, improving detection in deep water. AN/SQQ-89V16 suite, a proven undersea warfare system integrating hull-mounted sonars and acoustic processing.
The NATO Center for Maritime Research and Experimentation, known as CMRE, deploys research vessels and develops sonar as well as other underwater-related technology.
I think the future will entail a shift in the approach to ASW from a small number of expensive platforms to a very large number of cheap autonomous platforms.
Aviation support, flight deck and hangar for an MH-60R Seahawk helicopter, plus an unmanned aerial vehicle such as the MQ-8C Fire Scout, amplifying both ASW and ASUW capabilities. D electromagnetic warfare, EMW electronic warfare system, SLQ-32 variant, provides warning, interception, and jamming to foil incoming missiles. Network-centric ops, compatible with cooperative engagement capability, CEC, and tactical data links like Link 16, enabling collaborative targeting and data sharing across the fleet. Ship design and engineering, hull and displacement.
What we found on this program was that the Navy had poor metrics for understanding design progress. The biggest thing that we point out in our report is the Navy has proceeded with construction on the lead frigate without completing the design of the ship. So they're building a ship without actually having it designed.
A lengthened and widened variant of the Frem hull for enhanced survivability in space, likely displacing 7,200 to 7,400 tons full load. Propulsion, a combined diesel, electric, and gas, Yakodlag or similar, approach adapted for U.S. engines and reduction gears, as mandated by Buy American regulations. Automation and crew size designed for a smaller crew, around 200 personnel, by using automated machinery control and integrated combat systems. Why frigates? Cost efficiency, priced at around half that of a new Arleigh Burke destroyer. Balanced fleet composition, allows the Navy to maintain presence in multiple theaters without overcommitting high-end assets. ASW emphasis frees up destroyers for other missions while still delivering a significant submarine hunting punch. Distributed lethality helps the Navy spread out its striking power across more, smaller platforms. Procurement and costs. At least 20 hulls are planned in this class. Each new frigate will typically cost $1.1 to $1.2 billion, but the first in class is higher due to startup and detailed design costs. As of 2024, 6 ships are already funded. The Constellation class could expand further if the Navy adjusts its 30-year fleet composition plans, especially since older Ticonderoga-class cruisers are being phased out, leaving a void in the Navy's vertical launch capabilities. Currently, all FFG-62s are built at Fincantieri/Marinette Marine in Wisconsin. But the Navy has hinted that if production rates climb above 2 per year, or if Congress mandates more robust competition, a second shipyard could be added. A future competition might happen once the FFG-62 design is deemed mature, potentially around May 2025. Design decisions and challenges. Building on a parent design, in this case the Italian-French FREM, can reduce the time and cost of bringing a new platform into service. Even so, the FFG-62 design has diverged significantly from its FREM origins, introducing complexities in hull form, electronics integration, and compliance with American survivability standards. This shift has led to design stability issues and contributed to construction delays. By April 2024, the Navy cited a 36-month delay for the first ship, in large part due to starting construction before design completion and grappling with a tight labor market at the shipyard. Oversight issues for Congress. In light of these delays, Congress has several key concerns. 36-month delivery delay. How will this affect delivery dates for the entire class? And what's the Navy doing to stabilize the workforce? Cost growth. While the first 10 ships are under a fixed price incentive contract, persistent inflation and yard level challenges might raise production costs long term. Potential second shipyard. If the annual build rate goes above 2, is there a need for another yard to speed up delivery and inject competition into the program? VLS capacity. Each frigate carries 32 VLS cells, but some argue for increasing that number to 48 to offset the loss of Ticonderoga-class cruisers. Technical risk, integrating new propulsion and machinery control systems, plus adapting the FREM hull, poses challenges. Congress wants assurance these won't result in excessive cost or schedule overruns. The road ahead. So where does that leave us? Design completion. The Navy hopes to finalize the frigate's design by May 2025, paving the way for higher volume production and possibly additional shipyards. Cost and schedule pressures. Delays in the first ship's delivery could ripple through the entire program, potentially driving up costs. A critical multi-mission asset with robust capabilities in anti-submarine, anti-surface, and anti-air warfare, this frigate could be a linchpin in the Navy's strategy for distributed maritime operations. Long-term commitment. The success or failure of FFG-62 will shape not just the Navy's near-term fleet, but also its evolution in an era of heightened great power competition. The Constellation FFG-62 class represents a new cornerstone in the US Navy Surface Force, combining affordability, flexible mission sets, and proven technology. Yet it faces challenges, from design finalization to workforce retention, from supply chain issues to the test and evaluation of new propulsion systems. For the dedicated teams at Marinette and beyond, each step in the frigate's construction is a tribute to American industrial skill and a reminder of the program's high stakes. Congress continues to watch.
The Constellation-class guided missile frigate will be the Navy's next-generation small surface combatant warship.
So the second vessel of that class, the future USS Congress, will have a familiar face as one of the ship's sponsors, Virginia 2nd District Congresswoman Jen Kiggins. Mike Gunning spoke to her and takes a look at some of the problems the frigate faced in development.
all over the nation.
Secretary of the Navy Carlos Del Toro this week announced that the sponsors of the future Constellation-class guided missile frigate USS Congress, the second in the class, will be four members of Congress, Senators Tammy Baldwin and Joni Ernst, and Representatives Betty McCollum and Jen Kiggins. Kiggins said she is flattered to receive this honor.
Balancing the Navy's urgent need for these ships against industry constraints and the broader defense budget. Over the coming years, the Constellation-class frigate will either fulfill or redefine its promise as a multi-mission combatant, suitable for the U.S. Navy's global commitments. Stay tuned as we follow this warship's journey from blueprint to sea trials, and eventually frontline service, where America's maritime heritage meets the challenges of the 21st century. Thank you for joining us in this comprehensive look at the Constellation FFG-62 class frigate program. We'll be here with updates as the Navy's newest class of warship navigates the path toward deployment on the world's oceans. Remember to like and subscribe for more deep dives into cutting-edge military technology on combat tech. And thanks for watching.